Hello everyone, my name is G1 Spears. The topic of this presentation is a diagnostic assessment in clinical judgment, which is part of our continuing education series. Okay, I'd like to talk about how faculty can better develop and utilize test items for students. The problem is we cannot directly observe a student's competency or ability trait. Since ability is not directly observed, we are supposed to develop a test tool to estimate students' ability. In testing theory, an observable competency scale is regarded as a latent trait because it is not directly observed. Therefore, to estimate the latent competency of students, we have to make operationalized variable with test items. For instance, let's say our epsilon number two is apply critical thinking and clinical reasoning skills to deliver safe and quality care. What do you mean by safe and quality care? And what about critical thinking or clinical reasoning skills? We cannot directly observe what they are. Instead, we have to operationalize these ambiguous concepts into more measurable variables. In other words, these measurable variables are expressed as specific items. More importantly, we have to treat the item development or modification process as a scientific process, so we have to be able to justify our assessment as evidence-based evaluation as scientific evidence. The scientific method is about a decision-making process. It is about evaluating things and then coming up with a decision about it, the way that things can be analyzed. We believe that scientists have to make decisions based on the scientific method. The process developing or modifying a test item is really similar to the one formulating a scientific hypothesis. First part that we have to understand is that there is a difference between these two words, which are truth and fact. Truth is based on a belief system. If you believe it, it is true. If you don't believe it, you will say it is not true. We get into a lot of arguments about what is true and what is not true. And a lot of times we come up with the concept we can agree to disagree. Now we have fact. Fact is repeatable, which means you do it again, it comes out the same way. And when it comes out the same way, it is not something we can agree to disagree on. Whether or not you believe in gravity, whether or not you understand what gravity is, it doesn't matter because it is a fact and it works in a certain way. And a lot of people are confused with the two. And when you are confused with the two, it becomes problematic as a nursing scientist. Scientists need to deal with fact. You have to deal with fact because fact is the repeatable, but when you treat patients and teach students, we have different laws rather than scientists, right? We also have to have a hope or a value that we can improve their health conditions and their academic outcomes, etc. So here is a question. Which weighs more, a pound of feathers or a pound of gold? You look at it and say, what type of question is that? Because we all know the truth that a pound is a pound. We have been taught that a pound is a pound. Therefore, the question seems kind of bizarre, but what we've got to deal with is fact. Fact, a pound of feathers is 16 ounces. We all know that a pound is 16 ounces. Each ounce weighs 28.345 grams. If you get 16 times 28.3495, you get 453.492 grams, which is that value that we often learn when we want to learn how much is a pound. It's 454 grams. So we can make that conversion rather easily. So a pound of feathers weighs 454 grams. Another fact, an ounce of gold, which is measured in the Troy system, is 31.10 grams. Wait a second. We just changed the value of an ounce, right? Not even an ounce is an ounce. No, there are two different weights. And there are Troy, there are 12 troy ounces per troy pound. 12 times 31.1 equals 373.2 grams. You can look this up in the handbook of chemistry or physics. You can look this up on the web, and this is factual. Therefore, a pound of feathers weighs more than a pound of gold. So we have to be careful about what we are looking at, because scientists need to deal with fact, and this becomes important when we make these decisions. Scientific method is about a process which is about evaluating things and then producing a decision about it. It requires you to be observant. You'd better look around, and you have to see what's going on around you. As you look around, you become inquisitive. You ask questions. Questions we often ask are who, what, when, where, and how. Now that the last one in there, why? Okay, first, let's look at the first fives. We have who looks at a specific person. We have what is a request for specific information about something. We have when looks at a specific time frame, when would be the best time to teach how to dose medication, when would be the best time to measure the degree of pain, and these are often valid questions. Where with location? Where could we find something? Where is something more likely to occur? How? How does something work? How does then get from point A to point B? How says in what way are we are doing this, or in what manner? Now, when we look at these questions, we have who, what, when, where, how, which are all very viable questions about how to gather information about certain things so that we can deal with them. Second, I put why question in there because people love to ask that question, but that's not a really simple scientific question, because if something is repeatable, we can learn the who, the what, the when, the where, the how of it. But the why of it, we don't always understand. And why comes down to a higher level of understanding. And therefore, in good scientific method, we don't always ask why questions. We ask who, what, when, where, how, and once we got them down, we can kind of figure out our interpretation of why something happened. But it's not necessarily a why question. Now, how can you make decisions based on these facts? Piggybacking of the question, do we have to think of, that our curriculum and the assessment tests are an issue, and so we need to improve them? To answer the question, let's think about our assessment situation. if we have to think that the curriculum and assessment are an issue, why or why not? At least we have three facts here that we need to look at. In 2022, School of Nursing students performed below the national average in overall. However, the other fact says that the spring 2022 passing rate, 81.8%. This percentage reflects it is almost equivalent, or at least it's dramatically improved from the past passing rate at our school, because the quarter two of 2022 record shows that the current cohorts on time, they took the NCLEX exam on time. And so that number does not include the old alumni. More precisely speaking, 14 out of the 15 students passed the NCLEX exam at that time. Therefore, we do not necessarily have to think the curriculum is an issue because of these three facts. Congratulations for our success. But does this mean we are accountable enough for student success in terms of what we are doing on curriculum assessment, particularly with item formulation? Okay, now let's think about how we formulate an item then. Once you identify a variable at the construct level, and then you are trying to measure it. And so you are actually developing an item at the operational level. So if you come up with an item, that means you are coming up with the idea that the item measures the student's understanding of a concept. If you observe, student cannot get the right answer, then the status implies that student did not learn it. In other words, if the student didn't get the right answer, the idea holds, which is the student is not competent in that concept. In this stage, we are actually formulating a variable at the construct level, and we should be able to show that construct is deeply related to the developed item. This process is test item development, but this is probably the trickiest part because nurses are clinicians and they are not always analyzing kind of the distinction between construct and measurement. If we want to measure a targeted task, what we must do is we must control the other variables. Too often, we do science without controlling the variables. And if we do science without controlling the variables, then all of a sudden, it's no good. For instance, you want to measure students' reading abilities. Let's say you use a reading article using dinosaurs. You have to be able to control the other variables, not the reading ability itself, to measure reading ability. Some boys know more than girls about dinosaurs. Then regardless of their actual reading abilities, boys tend to have higher scores than girls in that test. There are many similar strange research studies. Not correctly measuring the targeted knowledge domain. The assessment process is similar to testing a scientific hypothesis. When we look at things like global warming, one of the reasons global warming is so polemic is because we cannot control all the variables because the scale is too big. How can you conduct an experiment by controlling all variables to prove or disapprove global warming? It is not like we could separate some little part out and deal with that, but no, we have to be able to control the variables and If you cannot control the variables, you don't get a good science experiment. Likewise, we should be able to control all variables to prove or disprove student competency. If you cannot control the variables, you don't get a good item. We have to have an item to measure what we are targeting to construct the construct, and we should be able to justify that what you are measuring is really to measure a targeted content domain competency, not the other kind of knowledge. Does this make sense? Scientific method has to control the variables. When we analyze the data, which means student responses to the test, the results are test statistics and item statistics. And positive results basically support the belief that students have learned the targeted contents and achieved the learning objectives. We also could have negative results, and negative results do not support the belief that students have learned the targeted contents. I'll talk about these negative values using point biserial in a minute. It doesn't necessarily mean that the specification of the item is wrong. The item development may be inaccurate to a certain extent. It may need to be changed a little bit. When we look at it, negative results don't support the belief. And then we've got non-result. And non-result say we've got a poorly conducted item development. Poorly conducted item development goes back to the concept we didn't control variables. If it's really a non-result because you didn't control the variables, and therefore you really didn't test what you were trying to test. The scientific method becomes very important in this because you have to be able to deal with this properly. Then we get to make conclusion and we get to evaluate our items. When we evaluate the item, we may find that the item was correct. We may find that the item needs modification. We may find that we need to go back to the drawing board. What we are doing is we are trying to gather more information, be observant, and try to conduct the item development. Item development is similar to formulating a research hypothesis. Scientific method becomes this process by which we evaluate things. Do you have any questions so far? What questions do you want students to answer with your test? This is a topic that we have to fully understand in order to be able to do proper amounts of item development and assessment. When you start, please start with the end in your mind. What is it that you want students to study? How do you want students to study it? And what sort of result do you want students to get out of it? And then you start asking the questions to them on how do they get to there from where we are starting at. And all of this becomes very important in learning how to ask a proper question. And the question always comes down to us is, how do we learn how to formulate a good question? Somebody once said, there are no such things as stupid questions, and that may not be accurate. We want to come up with good questions because based on good questions, we can measure students' competency in the targeted knowledge domain. We already mentioned who, what, when, where, and how. Then in this slide, I'm going to focus on why more. The question why is one that is often very difficult to understand. We often do something in life and somebody asks, well, why did you do that? And a lot of times we start thinking about a reason and we are going, I don't have a very good reason about why we did it. Oh, come on, you know, we just did it. It sounded good when we were thinking of it, and why is really a question that requires a synthesis of information. And a lot of times when we deal with why questions, we really aren't looking for something that we can document or prove, but rather what we are looking at is we are trying to gather a way that we can kind of understand something. But often why questions give us virtually no new information. It really comes down with the synthesis of information. So when we are asking questions, we need to look at all of these different ones. Why deals with for what purpose or what reason? And sometimes we don't know what the reason is, and we are not quite sure what the purpose is. Why requires interpretation of data and more than that? But why is not really the focal questions that you look at when you start doing item development. And it says right there, why requires a higher level of thinking and integrated knowledge and skills. So faculty better improve diagnostic assessment knowledge and skills. It's a part of course management as a continuing education credit. We want to recognize what features of the student task or content are important to analyze and thus support learning. Even if there were many faculty training sessions about Examsoft and ATI so far, we really want to make sure what these diagnostic systems, particularly with Examsoft, are addressing these issues because we can modify items on that platform. Okay, let's look at the features in Examsoft. I brought an output example from one course in the Examsoft. Are you familiar with this? Yeah. This exam one has 100 points, 100% point system. We see the total percentage score as 100 percent point in total and estimated test taking time here. And you see two big red rectangle. Examsoft contains both item statistics and person statistics. Let's figure it out which one is item statistics, which one is person statistics. Okay, on the top, you see average percent, Biserial 0.22, and upper 27% students have 0.1 points. So we better read these two values, percentage point rather than decimal point system, because it says the total point is 100 point scale. So this is 91, this is 71, and discrimination index is 0.2, and difficulty, item difficulty is 0.8. So regarding the meanings of these concepts, we'll get to that in a minute. And the bottom rectangle thing, this shows a point biserial. And although the average point biserial and the direct corrected discrimination index are shown, in divisor item, discrimination index is not here, but point biserial only is here. So when you have both average point biserial and a discrimination index, you better choose discrimination index because this is more accurate. But here, when you see the individual item discrimination with only the point biserial, we have to rethink what the meaning of each value is. Okay. So here, okay, now we see the average earned point for upper 27% students, 91 and lower 27% students, 71 points. So this is 27 is approximately similar with the 25%, right? So when we divide the student data into four pieces, quarter one, quarter two, quarter three, quarter four, okay. Each group has average score, right? So this is a quarter one student average score. This is a quarter. So whenever you have quarter one, quarter two, quarter three, so quarter three average score minus quarter one is here, 91 minus 71 is 20, okay? So this shows a variance of the data. And as I said before, when you see point Biserial and the discrimination index, we better choose the discrimination index because point Biserial is a little bit overestimated. But still, when you do not have this value here, then, and if you only see this value, then you better choose this one as an index for discrimination, item discrimination. And this green one is item difficulty. Item difficulty has a lot of synonyms. Difficulty, p-value is a probability value, item correct or item easiness. So item difficulty and item easiness are kind of different ways to indicate item difficulty. They are opposite meaning, but actually they are the same, right? Difficulty is opposite of easiness, right? But usually, conventionally, people say item difficulty, okay? All right, so among the five values here, point Biserial, upper 27% value, lower 27% students' average score, discrimination index, difficulty, which are item statistics, which are student scores. Yeah. So these are about students, right? Student data. And this 0.22, 0.2, 0.8, these three values are item statistics. Okay. Now, this is a different output example from Examsoft. So now the entire students' average scores, the average scores are represented as either mean or median. Okay, when we have the same numbers for mean and median, that means the data, students' score data, looks like symmetric, like this. In the center, we have three graphs here, and then in the center, so we see the mean and the median are the same. Okay, so that means our average students are converged into the center. But if you have some higher performers, more than high performance here like that, and this is positively skewed, and this is negatively skewed. So you have more liars in the left side. That means you have some low performing students here. So you have to deal with them, right? Or you simply investigate them as a case study, why they have so low scores. You know, you have to have a one-on-one, you know, individualized meeting, depending on what kind of data distribution, you have to have a different strategies to manage your class. Also, let's say this center graph and the bottom graph, they have the same mean and median, but the distribution, the scores are widely distributed in the bottom one, but the upper one is very narrow, right? This narrow one is students are located, most of students are located near the center score, but the bottom graph, students are widely distributed, right? So on the bottom case, if your class is just like bottom, it's hard to teach because your students' competency levels are really wide. So you don't know when you teach something, you don't know how you can focus, what type of, you know, ability levels, you know, would be appropriate, you know. But in this case, everybody is kind of, you know, converge to the center, then you're really focused on the level of these specific, you know, ability students, right? Okay, how about this output? So it shows number one, number two, item, three items here. And this column shows item difficulty, item correct. So again, here, you can say 0.86, 0.57, 0.1. But they happen to say percentage point. Anyway, whenever you see correct, you can say, you can think of, oh, this is item difficulty, p-value. So 0.86. So which one is the most problematic? Which item is most problematic? So this 100% means everybody get correct answers to this item. Then do we have to have this item? What do you think? So point biserial zero means, so this item does not distinguish high performer and low performer. Yeah, it's naturally, it's very, you know, intuitively, it's you know that, right? Because if everybody get the correct answers to the item, then that item does not distinguish good students and bad students, right? Okay, so although a good item, bad item on each threshold is given, is recommended by Examsoft, let's find out the concepts of the each you know item statistics in detail to make sure to understand all the important concepts. Let's deal with the definitions here. Okay, so difficulty, easiness, correct, p-value are synonyms. And item difficulty is defined as the number of persons with an item correct response divided by the total number of persons. So in this formula, p-value difficulty formula, the numerator is number of correct answers, and denominator is the number of entire students. Okay, so once you see the result for the specific item J, let's say you have 10 students and you have 4 students get correct answers to the item and the 6 students get incorrect answers to that item. So can you calculate the item difficulty here? So what is the numerator? What is the denominator? Okay, so yes, so since we have 4 students who get the correct answers, so the difficulty is 0.4, all right? But what if we nullify the item for some reasons? Then all of 6 incorrect and no credit are supposed to be changed credit, like, you know, 1 point. So original difficulty is 0.4. Now the difficulty has been improved to 1. Okay, numerator and denominator are the same. Okay, so let's read these 5 questions. Number one, how does it inflate the initial difficulty? Yeah, numerator should be changed from 4 to 10, right? Yeah, all correct answers. Number two, is nullifying an item better or worse than dropping the item? Why? So when you intended to make that item based on the concept, you thought the item is important. So that's why, you make the item. But then the item is too easy, or there is some problems to sophisticate in the item, so there is some problem. So you happen to nullify the item, and in that case, do you still need to keep the item, or you just simply remove the item? That is the question about question two. And question three, does this affect grade inflation? Yes, 0.4 to 1.0. So item difficulty level has been changed, improved, right? And question four, how many nullifications are acceptable in a test? Question five, is the number of nullified items something decisible at an individual instructor or at a collective level? Yeah, these two questions, we have to think about it. We cannot simply say any specific action is good or bad. Instead of saying the one way, what we need to do is how can we justify that action, the decision? That is more important one. And we teach different courses, so everybody has a different situation. So these are actually we have to think and discuss at a collective level in our committees. And the decision making about this answer question is also based on the what kind of courses that we teach. Are they entry level courses or advanced level courses? Things like that. According to Florida State Department of Education, we'd better make various levels of items to cover the full range of student abilities. Let's see the psychometric considerations for p-values. P-values are reasonable and most are between 0.25 and 0.9. The mean of p-values is probably preferably equal to or greater than 0.5, but there is no single absolute threshold. If a test question is too difficult or too easy, it will not be possible to accurately estimate the student's ability. Therefore, we need to develop a wide range of items so that one test can cover all the levels of student abilities. By the way, although we have recommended item difficulty threshold, it is not necessarily possible to estimate the ability of unobservable latent trait because we don't know if the result is because the student's abilities are too good or too bad, or if it is because items are too good or too bad. More importantly, the item difficulty measured in Examsoft and the new NCLEX exam are using different test theories. Now, we want to know how the NCLEX is testing student competency and deciding on pass or fail. There are at least two steps to understand the new generation NCLEX scaling. Most of all, NCLEX does not count the total number of correct items, while Examsoft uses a total test score method. In other words, Examsoft approach follows classical test theory, so the item statistics fall into sample dependency, which means the scores are the students' So even though I use the same item, every year I have different students, and the p-value is dependent on the samples. Okay, so it is difficult to recognize why, when, for instance, the p-value is 0.9, is it because students or items, why my students are so, you know, excellent, that's why I got p-value 0.9, or items are too easy, that's why I get, you know, p-value as 0.9, we really don't know. However, NCLEX uses a method of estimating pass or fail each time each student gets a question right or wrong. To do so, the first step is to put the item difficulty parameter on the same scale with the student ability parameter. So you see this diagram in the same scale, the person abilities are located in this scale, and also at the same time, item statistics are also located in this scale. So there are four different persons here. Let's say data one is first student's ability level. Data two is a different level, ability level, competency level. Data three, data four, and here B represents the item parameter of easiness or difficulty. Okay, so this mechanism is called as IRT, item response theory method. The test gives a metric to see relative locations among the student's cognitive attributes, student ability data. To measure the data, what we normally expect is the item that a low-ability student is unlikely to make a correct answer for certain questions, I mean, difficult questions. So the student, data one student, is hardly get the right answer for this hard question, B9 or BA, B7. Instead, in contrast, high performing student like data four will make more correct answers for both difficult question and the easy questions cumulatively. Difficult items are like B8, B7, things like that. So even B9, this B9 is beyond the data for student's ability, right? And in that case, the student is, data for student is unlikely to get a correct answer to the item B9. This is a very basic idea, and we really use the item characteristics to correspond to the student's ability, because we cannot directly see student ability because the student's competency is a latent factor. In sum, NCSBN uses IRT as the analytic technique to measure student ability, and this is estimated on computer adaptive test. Okay. So once the student ability is measured with 85 questions in the NCLEX exam, 85 questions is minimum number of questions in NCLEX, and some students can have more items than just 85 items, because when students guess the answers more than the other, then NCLEX, the computer cannot estimate students' ability precisely. So the number of items should be given to such a student more than the other. Mm-hmm. Does it make sense? When we advise students, we want to say like, we don't want to say like NCLEX exam is easy or it's too difficult like that. Because if we say it's easy, then it's kind of bragging, you know, and it's not good. Also, if we say it's too difficult, then student might be overwhelmed. So we would rather say like, oh, it's doable. It's doable. When we teach students, we better say the NCLEX is doable as long as you follow school's policy and faculty's guidance well, yeah, you'll be fine, something like that. So now we just completed item difficulty. Now, as item discrimination index, we want to learn point biserial. So definition is correlation between dichotomous variable and continuous variable. So original definition is like that. But what is the dichotomous variable? Dichotomous variable, you have only two choice or two options. So for the specific item, there's only two cases. Either a student get the item correctly or incorrectly, right? So, and then continuous variable here means total test score. So in sum, the point biserial means the extent that an item distinguishes high and low performing students. So one item can have ability to distinguish low performance and high performance. Okay, so one specific student's item response, for example, either correct or incorrect, dichotomous variable, and then what is the continuous variable? Total test score. Okay, average total test score. So you get the correlation between the each student's the item response, either correct or incorrect. That means one or zero. The continuous is the percentage score. So you get that relationship between two values, then it is called point biserial. And then that means the extent that an item distinguishes high and low performing students. So we have to be careful about the interpretation of item discrimination index. The Examsoft does not always provide corrected item discrimination index. So sometimes it gives a point biserial. When we have both options, then we choose a discrimination index. But when we have only point biserial, we have to remember that when we compare that value to the recommended threshold. Why? Because the definition between point biserial and corrected discrimination are index different. So as I said before, for point biserial, it used the definition item total correlation. Item, dichotomous variable, correct or incorrect, total score, continuous variable. So correlation between item and total score is point biserial. So the total score already include the targeted item. So this is bias. This is biased, right? That is why Examsoft corrected this value to generate this new value, discrimination index. So usually discrimination index is a little bit smaller than this point biserial, okay? So when we have two values here, we definitely choose this one. And the psychometric consideration threshold is given based on discrimination index 0.5. Okay, definitely we don't want to get negative values for point biserial or negative, I mean, discrimination index. Non-negative values here. That means if we have negative values, that means that item does not support the student has been learning that concept. Okay. Okay, so now what if we have point biserial only for the individual item? And if the point biserial is a 0.25, do we have to modify that item or not? I mean, the threshold is given based on the discrimination index, like corrected point biserial, not the pure point biserial, but the point biserial is given 0.25. And do you have to modify that item? What do you think? It's tricky. So if you see two indexes, a point biserial and discrimination index, then you choose, you check the discriminated index. But if you don't have this option, then you have to think about point biserial based on the threshold, recommended threshold is a 0.25. So if you see point biserial as a 0.25, you have to modify that item to improve that value a little bit higher than just to 0.25, because it's not corrected discrimination index. Does this make sense? Now, I want to talk about reliability. So reliability is test scores, how consistently the test produces scores for a particular sample of students. Okay, so in Examsoft, the reliability index is chosen as KR20. So KR20 is recommended 0.7 or higher than 0.7. However, reliability does increase with test length. In other words, if the number of test items is longer, the reliability tends to be high. A test can be very reliable for a particular sample, but maybe not for other samples. So it's hard to tell because reliability isn't not a universal property of a test. So, you know, test length, long test length is a high reliability. There is a, you know, correlation between two. So regardless of adding, you know, regardless of the good items or bad items, as long as longer test, higher reliability, right? So some people try to add just random questions just in order to improve reliability. So a high reliability index does not guarantee a preferable situation all the time. And also, there is no obvious evidence that the question is bad based on these three values: difficulty, discrimination, KR20. Okay. Item difficulty level. As I told you before, this is sample dependent. So we really don't know high difficulty level is because of high ability students or easy items. And discrimination is also embed difficulty, right? You remember the one problematic item, you know, 100% item difficulty gives you 0 point biserial. Do you remember that? So discrimination is really related to the item difficulty. Also, Availability is also related to the number of items, right? So there's no guarantee a preferable situation, even though we use and follow the old rules of thumbs of given threshold for item difficulty, point biserial, and reliability. We have to be careful. So therefore, next presentation, maybe I should make how to ensure validity, because reliability and item difficulty, item discrimination are not absolute values that we need to think of, oh, I make good items like that. There's no evidence about it, at least, even though it shows those three values shows, you know, my item is at least keep the general guideline, but that doesn't mean my item is really good or bad, anything like that. So far, we learned how to judge whether a test item is acceptable by using the Examsoft indexes, such as item difficulty and discrimination. Now let's apply the rules of thumb to our actual question in Examsoft. I received this question examples from Tammy. Thank you, Tammy. What are the problems of this question? Okay, you see this test results here. First, what is the answer? Okay, so here it shows the correct 90% point biserial minus 0.16. So correct 90% means, so is this too easy or not? Is this question distinguishing high performing students and low performing students? How do we know this? So point biserial definitely shouldn't be negative value, right? And the correct 90% means 9 out of 10 students got correct answers. This negative value is not really good. It doesn't support the hypothesis that students learn the targeted content based on the item statistics, right? So we have to modify this item. But how can you modify this item? But do you think this item is still necessary for some reasons? Yeah, for instance, my class students this semester are not very prepared. So they need the basic knowledge like that. That's how you think. This is a scenario. Just I make it up. If so, you would we what would you do for this? If so, instead of putting this question in Examsoft, you will want to upload this prerequisite or basic knowledge question as developmental purposes in Canvas. So like you post an announcement like students are required to solve these preliminary quizzes before they actually take the exams of the test, like that, something like that. And then once they solve all these kind of developmental quizzes as a preliminary activity, and then you decide like satisfactory or not satisfactory, and then once they pass the satisfactory threshold, then they are supposed to go to Examsoft to take the real exams. Does this make sense? Yes, students require additional processes sometimes. So I would diagnose this item like this. What motivation brought this kind of item? And it's because I believe my class students need remediation. So I give this solution, like use separate developmental quizzes using the lowest domain knowledge for diagnostic purpose. Of course, you can modify this item directly in the Examsoft if you want to post it in Examsoft. And also your course is matched with that level, course level, you know, according to the BSN nursing program level metrics. If that course is, you know, like very entry level course, you still can include this kind of item in the Examsoft. Yeah. Anyway, it needs some work so that the item can be congruent to the course level and require the clinical, critical reasoning skills. Next, this question is about negligence. Negligence means not doing what a person has to do. So here, correct, item difficulty, 0.43. Discrimination index, point biserial is 0.62. Okay, really high, right? So since we have the discrimination index, the threshold is 0.5. So discrimination index here, 0.83, this is even higher than that, right? So we don't have any issue about discrimination here. So I will say this item is fair enough. So there are four response categories, A, B, C, D. Now, each response category shows a scenario or a problem in the real world. Without knowing the negligence construct, you know, a student is unable to solve this item. So I would say this is a good item. That's it. Thank you for your patience, and please feel free to email me if you have any questions or concerns or any feedback on this presentation. I wonder what the most important keyword in your mind remains after this presentation. Also, for the next presentation, please email me if you have any assessment topics to let me deal with. If there are not any other preferences, I'm going to prepare for item validation process, focus on content and response processes, evidence-based evaluation, because item difficulty, point biserial thresholds are relative and conventional rules of thumb. We need more solid content and response process validation-based evidence to whether student is proficient or not. Thank you.